You can best appreciate the specialness of Egypt from space, or if you can't run to space travel, then from a plane. And what you do is you look down and you can just see this vast stretch of golden brown desert, and then running through the centre of it, a ribbon of magic. The blue of the Nile and the green of the fertile Nile Valley all around. This was geography's gift to the region. But of course, it took nous and determination to turn that geographical luck of the draw to the Egyptians' advantage. The Egyptians were key players in North Africa and the Middle East for thousands of years. But rather than think of them as some kind of monolithic entity, the ancient Egyptians, it's actually much more satisfying to get to the bottom of the stories of the individuals who made them so great. Through the old and the new kingdoms, the fortunes of Egypt changed, and there was a particular group of people who helped to catalyse that change. These were the pharaohs. Now, don't forget, this was a time when the pharaoh was thought to have one foot on earth and one foot planted very firmly in the heavens, a person capable of superhuman endeavours. So, in this film, we look at the genius of two particularly high-achieving pharaohs who actually lived 1,200 years apart. First up is Khufu, the man who's burnt his name into the popular imagination by constructing the giant pyramid at Giza to house his tomb. And secondly, we meet the pharaoh Ramses II. Now, Ramses lived in very different times when things were politically very jumpy, and his priority was to promote the Ramses brand right across the region. It's something he did in a spectacularly ambitious form with the rock-carved temple at Abu Simbel. Even as a child, I was gobsmacked by the magnificence of these endeavours. But what I hope that this film does is to use 21st century technology to investigate not just the what, but the how and the why. And one of the real treats for me is when we take a computer right inside the superstructures to analyse how they were made and what that can tell us about the inner lives of the pharaohs who constructed them.
Egypt, one of the most impressive civilizations the world has ever known. We think we know Egypt. The awesome, ruthless power of the pharaohs. The golden tombs. The astonishing building projects that defied the limits of technology. But the truth is far more intriguing. Ancient Egypt was not one kingdom, but many, each ruled by pharaohs who faced different challenges and wrote different chapters in the tale of human civilization. This is the story of the architectural legacy of two of the greatest pharaohs. Under them, Egypt enjoyed two golden ages of monumental building. The first, one of the great innovators of history, the preeminent pyramid builder of the Old Kingdom, Khufu. The second ruled more than 1,000 years later. He was probably the most famous pharaoh in a newly resurgent Egypt, Ramses II. These aren't tales of tyrannical cruelty to achieve feats of miraculous engineering, but the story of a real people with an unshakable belief in a single man, their God King.
Both of these men craved one ultimate prize, an eternal life amongst the gods. But they also shared something else, and that was a gargantuan drive to achieve power here on Earth. Ramses II believed that he was the most powerful pharaoh of all time. He commissioned thousands of statues of himself that he then dispersed throughout his kingdom. It is the most brilliantly megalomaniac exercise in branding. But because artifacts like this survive, and they're very charismatic, it means that we can begin to try to understand the psychology of the man. The situation with Khufu, though, is rather different. Khufu was operating 4,500 years ago, So it's hardly surprising that his character has been virtually obliterated by the sands of time. Still, we do have one measure of his raw ambition, his extraordinary architectural legacy, an extreme fortress tomb, the Great Pyramid.
For almost 4,000 years, the Great Pyramid at Giza was the largest man-made structure on the planet. It was built at the height of what is now known as the Old Kingdom. It was a time before writing became commonplace. Records are rare. Just think of it. Largely illiterate men with the simplest of tools could coordinate to create one of the wonders of the world. Pyramids inhabit our imaginations as something mysterious, unfathomable. To understand the Great Pyramid, we need to understand an otherwise shadowy figure from history, an enigmatic pharaoh called Khufu. How did his people build such an ambitious structure? What was its purpose? Luckily, his monument can give us some answers. If you know how to interpret them, they lie in the stones, the passageways and the chambers of this remarkable structure, and in the care and precision of the engineers who raised it. Through this building, we can start to bring an ancient civilization to life. Their concerns, their belief systems, but above all, their dedication to Khufu, the pharaoh who for over 20 years was the most powerful human being in the known world. To try to get into the minds of the Egyptians of the Old Kingdom, you need to appreciate their religion and their complex concept of the afterlife. 2,500 years before Christ, Sneferu, the first pharaoh of the fourth Egyptian dynasty, lay dead, and his son Khufu prepared to take the throne. His father had been an incredibly popular king, but his people weren't mourning. They believed that life continued after death, and his father's death was especially significant. Because in the afterlife, the dead pharaoh's spirit would join the gods. In death, the pharaoh could influence the gods, encourage them to look after the living, and when the time came, to shepherd their spirits safely across to the afterlife. But his father's place amongst the gods was not guaranteed. First, there were precise rituals to initiate. The dead king's body had to be embalmed, and those preserved remains must stay untouched for all eternity. So important were these two rituals that even as Sneferu's body was being prepared, there's evidence that Khufu was already planning for his own death. His life will be little more than a preparation for the afterlife, where he will provide security and wealth for his people for all eternity. It's really hard for us to credit, but Egyptians bought into this idea unquestioningly, which gave Khufu enormous strength.
Khufu has more power and authority than any other ruler in Egyptian history or perhaps world history. He is a living god with absolute command over all of his subjects.
Through immortality, Khufu's glory and the prosperity of his people were inextricably linked. The key would lie in the preservation of his dead body. And no pharaoh in history has done more to ensure his mummy would remain safe than Khufu's own father, Sneferu. To try to understand how the ancient Egyptians lived, we have to explore the cities they built for their dead. Burial monuments were as old as mankind itself, but the pyramid was still a very recent development. The forerunners of the pyramids were rectangular tombs called mastabas, made out of mud brick. But as Egypt grew wealthier, the mastabas got grander, and the pharaohs built the grandest tombs of all. Placing one mastaba on top of another created a tomb fit for a pharaoh,
the first basic pyramid was born.
By the time Khufu's father came to the throne, these step pyramids were already the ultimate status symbol. Over his 50-year reign, Snefru took the art of the pyramid to new heights. His first pyramid had stepped sides. Then he tried, unsuccessfully, to build a smooth-sided pyramid. Finally, Snefru achieved his goal, the world's first true pyramid. Now, his son's ambition was to perfect what his father had started.
Khufu is looking at this and thinking, you know, I can do it better. I can learn from the mistakes that my father made. I can build something bigger, grander, something that will really capture the attention of both my own people and anyone coming into Egypt.
The sons of powerful men have often wanted to mark their own territory, to have a visible impact on the landscape. The new pharaoh, Khufu, chose to build his pyramid north of Egypt's ancient capital, Memphis, on a plateau at Giza, where no previous king had been buried. It would be the biggest single stone structure the world had ever seen. Khufu's father died believing that he'd perfected the pyramid, but Khufu intended to take the art form to the ultimate expression, to cement his own place in eternity. And he would throw the entire resources of a nation at his grand project.
This is a monument that Khufu is making to say, here I am, look at me, I am king, I have power, I have wealth. On the other hand, it's also his tomb. And Khufu's thinking about the fact that he needs a place where he can transform, where he can rise into the afterlife, join with the gods.
The project would cost a fortune, but then Khufu was unbelievably wealthy. The source of Egypt's prosperity is one of the greatest rivers on earth, the Nile. The river teemed with fish, perch and mullet and catfish. It was a major trade route. And its annual floods brought Egypt's farmers life-giving water and astonishingly fertile mud.
Egypt is the gift of the Nile, and basically the rest of Egypt is just one large chunk of desert.
The Nile is Egypt's lifeblood, its highway, the reason why Egypt survives in the middle of the world's largest desert, the Sahara.
The Egyptians believed that their pharaoh's privileged relationship with the gods intimately linked to the Nile's generosity.
The fact that the Nile flooded was in part due to things being right in the world in a cosmic sense, in a sense that the gods were placated, they were happy, things were being done correctly.
But despite his wealth, success was by no means assured. A pyramid so huge would take decades to complete, and in ancient Egypt, even a pharaoh could die young. If Khufu didn't live to see his great pyramid completed, his dreams of immortality would be blown apart. The Egyptians' security, their very souls, would be in jeopardy.
Even as a young man, it's vitally important that Khufu start his pyramid and finish it during his lifetime. He doesn't know how long he will rule. He could die at any time.
Khufu and his people knew that time was not on their side. They had to complete this massive project.
The Egyptian Old Kingdom just has to be one of the most vigorous and groundbreaking epochs in the whole of human civilization. This was a society that left behind a prehistoric mindset and mastered a really beautiful and distinctive form of writing. But of course, we are talking about 2,500 years before Christ, and so much of that writing hasn't survived.
We just don't have the personal correspondence and the architectural plans that would give us a clue to how a man like Khufu planned and built his great work. So what we have to do is interrogate the pyramid itself.
Khufu's Egypt occupied much the same sort of area as modern Egypt, although its population was 50 times smaller. No more than 1.5 million people. But if Khufu wanted a pyramid that would dazzle the gods, he would need an enormous workforce. Around 25,000 healthy young men. It would be the greatest mobilization of people that Egypt had ever seen. So where did he raise them? Khufu owned thousands of foreign slaves from incursions into Libya and Nubia. It's an enduring myth that these captives built the Great Pyramid. The story fits our technicolor fantasies that Egyptian wonders were built on the blood and sweat of slaves, on broken lives. But it's not true. Modern-day analysis of DNA taken from the bones of the workers proves that they were not foreigners, but native Egyptians. Free people. And we now believe there were very good reasons why Khufu didn't have to press gang men to work for him.
To actually be somebody who is helping guarantee that the current pharaoh will pass successfully into the next world is quite an important contribution to society. And it's a part of the cosmic insurance policy, if you like, for an Egyptian to make sure his king is properly buried, and therefore to work on his pyramid, it has a very definite personal importance.
Each labourer had an emotional investment in making this project work. Khufu's relationship to his people was far less tyrannical, far more paternalistic than has previously been thought. But for a long time, it's been very hard to see how so many of Egypt's farmers could be diverted from food production without crippling Egypt's economy. Today, Egyptologists believe the answer lies in the seasonal ebb and flow of the river. The Egyptians organised the building schedule around the river's flood season. The floods stopped farmers from working for up to 4 months of the year. If he organised his schedule carefully, Khufu could offer an attractive alternative.
The annual flood of the Nile is terribly important for building the pyramid, because when the Nile is flooding, they're 3 months or 4 months out of the year where the peasants can't really work the land. So the king very cleverly has organised it so that during those 4 months where they would be out of work anyway, they can actually be gainfully employed.
Scheduling the most labour-intensive periods of the build around the flood season is a solution that kept everyone happy. The flooded Nile was also the most efficient means of transporting men and materials. This ancient waterway, over 4,000 miles long, fed Khufu's grand project. As the building site at Giza stood nearly 5 miles from its banks, engineers carved a canal system through the fields that lay between. The building that was about to take shape was more than a fortress grave. Its design was infused with powerful religious symbolism. We now think that perhaps the classic pyramid shape represented the creation of the world. The first part of the land to rear up out of the water was a great mountain. The Egyptians named it Tahtjenen and made it one of their gods. Like the Garden of Eden, this place was harmonious and blissful, an earthly paradise. This primeval state of perfection was known as Maat. A pyramid shape echoes the emerging land and represents this perfect state.
Maat is basically truth or order, the right way, as opposed to the way of chaos. So for the Egyptians, one balances Maat, which is order, against chaos, and the world is always chaotic, and the king has to maintain this balance between the two.
Khufu's pyramid had to strictly follow the rules of Maat. These were the magical sparks that would transform a giant pile of stones into a stairway to the afterlife. His first critical act
was to align the pyramid with the heavens, a mysterious place just beyond mortal human experience, and home of the gods. The greatest of the gods to be honoured was the sun god Ra. Ra, they believed, carried the sun across the sky from the east to the west. When the pyramid was completed, the east and west walls would face the rising and setting sun, honouring Ra's journey. But the east-west alignment wasn't the most crucial. Khufu and his priests believed that although the perfect state of Maat is rarely achieved on Earth, it could still be found in the night sky, at the site of their North Star, Tuban.
By configuring it to point towards the North Star, it makes a stronger connection between his own preservation of order and the order in the heavens.
To realize this massive undertaking, one foot on the earth, one foot in the heavens, from every corner of the kingdom, the men of ancient Egypt converged on Giza. This gathering was, in all probability, the largest workforce ever assembled in the history of mankind. The scorching heat of the Giza Plain would be home to some of them for decades. As his engineers marked out the pyramid's ground plan, the workers would get their first glimpse of the scale of the task ahead. It would not have been a comforting sight.
The thoughts going through one's mind when looking out over the Giza Plateau on sort of almost day one, those thoughts must be, how on earth are we ever going to do this? It's fairly daunting to think, okay, there's nothing here now. In 20 years, we're going to have a mountain here.
These men had to build the pyramid before Khufu died, and it had to be perfect. This was a huge structure. The potential for error was massive, as Khufu's own father had learned. Snefru might have finally achieved the first perfect pyramid in his Red Pyramid, but he made some major mistakes along the way. His first attempt at a true pyramid ended in disaster. He sighted the structure on an area of desert where the bedrock was a little unstable. So as the sides rose, the foundations started to crack. In a desperate bid to lessen the load, halfway up, they reduced the angle of the pyramid's sides, creating the bent pyramid, but at some price. The pyramid's glaringly imperfect shape broke the rules of Maat, devaluing it as a resurrection machine. Snefru was lucky enough to reign for more than 50 years, long enough to start over and finally achieve his goal. But Khufu couldn't gamble on having that luxury. He might only have one shot at getting his pyramid right. And his priority was to ensure that his pyramid was built on solid foundations.
Khufu's definitely looking to not repeat the mistakes his father made. He's looking for a place where the limestone foundation is a bit stronger, where he can actually use that to his advantage to construct an enormous monument.
That's why, in a land made up mostly of mud and sand, Khufu's surveyors identified the perfect spot as the stony plateau of Giza. Giza's bedrock promised Khufu solid foundations, but it also brought another big bonus: an inexhaustible supply of top-quality limestone. A quarry right on the pyramid's doorstep at a stroke would cut millions of man-hours from the project.
Khufu may be thinking, you know, my sons could build here as well. I can set up a sort of family generation of tombs on this one site because the plateau is so large. And I can house my workforce nearby. I can put them off at the edge of the plateau near to the cultivation area. And so it's a site that has a lot of different things going for it.
The pyramid would swallow almost 2.5 million blocks of limestone, weighing an average of 2.5 tons each. Some of the blocks at the base of the pyramid were even heftier, as much as 15 tons. Khufu and his engineers had made a good start. Solid foundations and an abundance of stone. But they still faced a big challenge. They had to ensure that every stage was constructed absolutely level. If it was rising even slightly out of line, it would be imperfect, useless, a disabled insult to the very gods it was aiming to delight. Egyptologists believe that the engineers used a basic but effective levelling device. Two pieces of wood the same length were fixed to a crosspiece, creating an isosceles triangle, and a mark was made precisely halfway on the crosspiece. A plumb line hung from the apex intersected the crosspiece at the halfway mark, only when it was placed on a level surface. The instrument, called a square level, allowed the engineers to check that every stone was perfectly horizontal. The device was simple, but incredibly effective. As Khufu's great project started to take shape, each side of the pyramid base, over 2 football fields long, were almost perfectly horizontal, less than an inch out. Workers faced a daunting daily schedule. In a 10-day week, they only had 1 day of rest. We know that the teams of quarrymen cut and delivered 1 stone block every 3 minutes to the pyramid. Each limestone block was hacked from the rock face and cut to size in situ. They had really simple tools, primitive stone pounders and chisels made of copper, which is a relatively soft metal. Mind you, limestone is easier to cut than many other kinds of stone. The ancient Egyptians used the same tools to cut stone for centuries, and it would be another 500 years before they started using bronze to create a new generation of much tougher tools. Like their forerunners, Khufu's builders relied on dogged persistence and sheer man numbers to succeed.
The fundamental thing about Egyptian technology at this time is it's practical technology. They don't really go in for speculative stuff. It's what do we need to get the job done, and that's really as far as they wish to go.
Once each stone was roughly prepared, the quarry workers had to get them to the building site. Even though the quarry was beside the pyramid, it was a mammoth undertaking. Most of the stones were many tons in weight. Did they carry 6 million tons of stone up the side of the emerging pyramid? Once again, it seems the solution was simple and practical. Their near neighbours, the Sumerians, had been using wheeled carts for over 1,000 years. Khufu's engineers would certainly have been aware of the technology. But the sheer weight of the stones and the build-up of sand would have made carts hugely impractical. The Egyptians opt for the more straightforward approach. They built an enormous ramp and simply dragged the blocks on wooden sleds. The ramp was made from quarried rubble and stone, and lined with wooden treads to help the sled move more easily. The rampant sled system had been around for at least a century, and it allowed 20 men to haul 2-ton blocks of stone up the side of the pyramid. In the past, the Egyptians' refusal to use wagons has been seen as an example of their entrenched traditionalism. Not so. These men are just systematically getting the job done. That said, it's a low-tech, labour-intensive solution that is brutally tough on the workers.
No matter how you cut it, building a pyramid is back-breaking work. We actually have the bones of some of the men that built these pyramids, and they all show the strain and stress of its construction.
The workers' skeletons are a grim record of their lives. Broken or deformed bones, severed limbs, damaged spines. Tests suggest that the men's average lifespan was just 32 years, compared to 55 for a member of the nobility. A punishing price that Khufu's workers paid without complaint, because their labour secured his and their immortality, as long as the job could be completed in time. Stone by stone, Khufu's Great Pyramid was slowly taking shape. The blocks arrived unfinished. The underneath and one side were carved flat, but on-site masons finished the surfaces, smoothing the sides and then the top to create perfectly level faces. This massive workforce brought with them their own logistical problems. Around 25,000 men are generally thought to have worked on his grand project. 4,000 cutting, hauling and finishing the stone, and more than 20,000 in support jobs. Over the course of a year, that accounted for around 1 in 30 of Egypt's male population working on the pyramid. One of the most exciting discoveries of recent years, somewhere you feel just a breath away from the long dead, has been the workers' village. Once again, it seemed Khufu's solution was characteristically pragmatic and single-minded. He ordered an entire town to be built, just half a mile from the pyramid site. For some, such as stonemasons and other master craftsmen, it was their home for over 20 years. Accommodation was basic, but the town had a sophisticated infrastructure with bakers, potters and brewers, even teachers and physicians. Scribblings from ordinary Egyptians show us there was a community spirit and a buzzing street scene.
If you're coming to work in the pyramid for 2, 3, 10 years, you have your entire family housed there. Your children will have to go to school there. You will have medical facilities, there'll be places for entertainment. All the women will have their jobs, so it is a very large, thriving, bustling city.
Each worker almost certainly got a daily ration of 10 loaves per family and a generous beer ration. To peasant farmers, it must have seemed the high life.
All the people who are working for the king are being very well fed, much better than if they had stayed home and remained peasants on the land, because the king gives them meat and poultry and fish and bread and beer, plus extra rations that they can send back to their extended families at home. So they are really getting food fit for a king.
Organising the thousands of men into an effective, coherent workforce was perhaps the biggest challenge. The Egyptians achieved a level of coordination, efficiency and camaraderie that would put many modern building projects to shame.
It's their ability to organise, because no rabble would ever have been able to build even any of the pyramids, you know, given if they were given a century to do so.
The foreman devised a complex chain of command that ensured everything ran like clockwork. They divided the main workforce of 4,000 into two crews. These crews were then split into two gangs, and these divided down further, finally reaching units of 10. The system ensured everyone knew exactly his daily targets and who he answered to. It was hardly a coincidence that these basic 10-man units were also the ideal number to work on a single block, making each unit the driving force of the build. Splitting workers into these small groups made the project easier to control and had an added bonus. Their overseers could up the work rate by introducing a little competition. The first teams to hit the overseer's target would be rewarded with extra beer rations.
There definitely are psychological tricks that are in play here. Ways to get these guys to work faster, ways to get them to compete a little bit, to get that stone raised a little higher, to get that extra block in place before the end of the day.
It must have seemed like achingly slow progress. But stone by stone, the world's largest building project began to take shape. In the Old Kingdom, the pharaoh was truly a remote figure, a god king. If he visited the site at all, it would have been thrilling for the workers lucky enough to catch a glimpse of him.
The king's person has definitely sort of supernatural aura about it. So if you were doing work on the pyramid and he was appearing, that certainly would have been quite something to tell your grandchildren about.
Once the foundations were in place, the pyramid reached a critical phase. Using later evidence, we can extrapolate back to this period to envisage the task ahead of the workers. Deep in what would become its core, engineers constructed their pharaoh's burial chamber. This was where his mummified body would be laid. After intense religious ceremony, the belief was that he could begin to make a journey to meet his makers. Although Khufu expected to join the gods after his death, it was vital that his body remain preserved and untouched.
Khufu was the first king to decide that his body should be sealed up in one of these. It's a sarcophagus, and the word translates as flesh eater. This has been carved out of solid granite, which was the toughest rock available to the Egyptians. And really, it's a kind of fortress for corpses. And you can see that this one's got some decoration down here, but Khufu's tomb was absolutely austere. It was a simplicity that was designed to put people off the scent, because round in here were rich ritual goods that would accompany Khufu on a glittering journey to the afterlife. And of course, it's all the mind-blowingly beautiful stuff in here that's attracted tomb raiders and archaeologists alike over the centuries.
And that was the pharaoh's living nightmare. If Khufu's body was harmed or removed, the tomb tampered with, his eternal soul would perish, leaving his people unprotected and his mouldering corpse shut out of paradise. Paradoxically, of course, the sheer scale of a pyramid advertised the pharaoh's treasure-filled tomb far and wide, making it a magnet for tomb robbers. Egypt's first ever pyramid, the Step Pyramid, was created by the pharaoh Djoser. To protect his mummy, he had his builders excavate nearly 100 feet into the bedrock beneath the pyramid to create a secret burial chamber. But in the early 19th century, when opportunist adventurers reached the interior, they found that it had been devastated by thieves. Then, when archaeologists finally penetrated the burial chamber itself in the 1930s, all that was left were a few pitiful fragments. Khufu's fear was to meet a fate such as this. So his design team ensured that the main passages could be blocked, rock solid after burial. To deter the tomb robbers, his engineers also constructed his burial chamber from granite. The stone was specially sourced from a quarry 580 miles away. It's harder than steel and near impossible to tunnel through. But the chamber was just the start. His chief engineer devised a further set of security features. When the pharaoh's body was placed in the burial chamber, a series of three granite slabs would be lowered into place, sealing him inside. As a third line of defense, another series of giant slabs would be released, blocking the ascending corridor that links the chamber to the main entrance passage with impregnable granite. Khufu believed his pyramid would be a fortress. But as the pyramid grew, it seems that the engineers discovered a potential flaw in their plans. This burial chamber was the first ever to be built with a flat granite ceiling, and they feared that it might not be strong enough to support the weight of the pyramid above. With the spectre of Sneferu's bent pyramid before them, they decided to make double sure. They devised a series of stress-relieving chambers 68 feet high above the burial chamber. At the top, huge lintels were intended to channel the immense load away from the chamber itself. Today, we know that these relieving chambers were completely useless, but they clearly set the ancient architects' minds at rest. We believe it took two decades for the pyramid to reach its final stages. Khufu had survived to see his pyramid climb to an impressive height. But the work was far from finished. Polished stone cladding would transform the pyramid from a pile of carefully laid stones into a dazzling monument, a beacon, an aesthetic as well as an architectural triumph. His workers still had many months of hard labour ahead of them. Highly skilled stonemasons encased the rough-hewn stepped blocks with high-quality white limestone. They had to ensure the casing stones fitted against each other perfectly with no visible gaps. Then they carved and polished the limestone to an iridescent, smooth finish. They worked with chisels that were just a third of an inch wide. Full-time chisel sharpeners toiled alongside the stonemasons to keep them supplied with freshly honed blades.
The casing stones, which when they're added to pyramids, change their appearance completely. Rather than being sort of fairly dull, these casing blocks are fairly highly polished. And with the sun in the right direction, they almost make the pyramid gleam, almost like it's made of polished silver.
But the finish was more than just cosmetic.
Anyone approaching Khufu's pyramid after it's been sealed up will have no idea how on earth anything could have been placed inside it, or how you would even try to get into it. It'll just be one huge, smooth-sided pyramidal structure.
When the casing was completed, it concealed all trace of the entrance to Khufu's chamber. Just imagine it. His pyramid was a giant, shimmering, sublime, inscrutable puzzle. A puzzle that Khufu and his engineers must have believed was impossible to crack. Twenty years after he started, the pharaoh Khufu had survived to see his masterpiece complete. He and his subjects had won his race with death, and in the process had created a benchmark of human civilization.
Khufu in the end was probably the most audacious of pharaohs. If he wanted to be guaranteed to have a complete pyramid when he died, he should have built a smaller one. But in fact, he built the largest ever built. There was no guarantee that he was going to live long enough to see it even half complete.
Combining simple technology with extraordinary resolve and determination, his people had delivered the vision. It must have been a proud, inspiring moment.
The fact that you've probably outdone what your grandfather did when he was working for Snefru must have given a certain intense satisfaction there, and possibly also a feeling that having done it that much, probably nobody's ever going to quite manage something quite that big again.
The Egyptians are rejoicing. The pyramid is complete. The afterlife of the king is ensured. He will join with the gods. He will preserve order in the afterlife. So this is a time when all of Egypt is in celebration.
Khufu built a pyramid at Giza that was the tallest structure in the world and remained so for 4,000 years. But the pharaoh barely had time to enjoy it. Having, against the odds, seen his pyramid completed, Khufu died. By our standards, probably still only a middle-aged man. For over two decades, an entire country had worked and planned for one moment. Now, they would lay their pharaoh to rest in his resurrection chamber. From the chamber, they were convinced that his spirit would ascend to the heavens. As long as his body remained safe for eternity, when the time came, he would help their own souls to make the same journey. The engineers had created two shafts, over 200 feet long, on either side of the chamber. These were the secret passages through which the pharaoh's spirit could leave and re-enter the pyramid. Now his spirit would reside among the stars in the heavens, home of the gods. There he would repay his people's great sacrifice by guarding over them for eternity. And for the generations of Egyptians that followed Khufu, it must have seemed that the Great Pyramid was proving its worth, reaping rich rewards. Egypt was prosperous and peaceful. Khufu's son and grandson built their own pyramids on the Giza Plateau. But none surpassed Khufu's extraordinary monument. It remained the pinnacle of ancient Egypt's pyramid builders. And Khufu's divine status was assured. Centuries after his death, he was still worshipped as a powerful god. And it's been suggested that the Sphinx, world famous and still resolutely enigmatic, might even have been a tribute to the now legendary God King. After Khufu's reign, Egypt enjoyed almost 400 years of unbroken peace and prosperity. The country was stable, its people slept peacefully in their beds at night, their stomachs were full.
It seemed as if the gods were happy. But sometime soon, the spell would have to break. Khufu's cosmic insurance policy would no longer offer any protection. Eventually, the stability of Egypt descended into chaos, and Khufu's architectural achievements were never matched. This visionary pharaoh illuminated the Old Kingdom during the early stages of Egypt's development. Khufu was lucky. He lived in an age of wealth, a time of plenty, relatively free of the threat of invasion. Without the distraction of war, famine, or epidemic disease, this was a rare time when an entire generation could dedicate themselves to a single project of national importance. But the fundamental purpose of the pyramid was to deliver their pharaoh immortality. And to preserve their king's body, they created the greatest fortress tomb in history. They believed that its ingenious security system would form an impassable barrier to even the most determined tomb robbers for eternity. 820 AD, long after the ancient Egyptian empire had fallen, an Arab caliph hunting for treasure tried to tunnel into the Great Pyramid. Meeting the first set of granite blocks, his men tunneled over them, entering into the passageway's ceiling. And on reaching the slabs barring the entrance to Khufu's burial chamber, they simply chiseled through the doorframe where the granite was thinner. But inside, they discovered it empty. Someone had got there first. Khufu's mummy, along with the unimaginable treasures, had gone. Ultimately, Khufu's lifetime mission to protect his remains for all eternity had failed.
Khufu is not having a good afterlife. The whole point in building this pyramid was to get into the afterlife. This was what was so important. And because his remains don't last, his job was completely unfinished.
In the end, Khufu and his people were betrayed by descendants from new civilizations they could only imagine. Their carefully laid plans, preserving the king's body in a work of art to guarantee his and their own immortality, were pathetically frustrated.
We're actually really lucky to be talking about Khufu at all, because his name was nearly forgotten by history. He is name-checked in a few places, on the walls of tombs of high-ranking officials and priests, and on a few artefacts. There's a really lovely little statuette where he's name-checked. But none of this evidence is very articulate or very expansive. I mean, even here on this inscription, we just get his name and the fact that he was associated with the god Horus. It's very hard to get a sense of the real man.
But Khufu, the master builder, does live on, thanks to the Great Pyramid. Through it, he has triumphed over death. He illuminated the Old Kingdom, and he still commands the respect of men and women born over 4,000 years after his death. Now he will always be remembered as Egypt's most visionary pharaoh. Remarkably, though Egypt would later become much more powerful, it would be more than 1,000 years before a pharaoh appeared who could begin to match Khufu's architectural achievements. After the death of the great pharaoh of the pyramid era, Khufu, Egypt enjoyed almost 400 years of unbroken peace and prosperity. But then the unthinkable happened. The River Nile, Egypt's beating heart and the source of all its wealth, went bad.
Egypt's prosperity fundamentally relies on the Nile flood. If the Nile flood is too high or too low, famine's going to result. You're either not going to have your crops properly watered or everything's going to be washed away. Nowadays, it's fairly clearly understood that that is what brought it all to an end.
When the Nile was reduced to a trickle, crops failed and widespread famine followed. The gods were obviously unhappy. The privileged relationship the pharaohs apparently had with the immortals
had gone sour.
The kings lose control. They no longer are perceived as being strong and powerful the way Khufu certainly was in his day. They can't control what's happening.
Egypt eventually recovered, but after a second period of prosperity, the Nile failed the pharaohs again, leaving their people vulnerable to another threat. Invasion by a people called the Hyksos.
They are a conquering force. They come with chariots that the Egyptians haven't seen before. They come with composite bows that have much better range and accuracy. They come with a force that catches Egypt by surprise.
The country fell to the invaders.
You have something which has never occurred before, and which Khufu certainly never would have thought to have occurred, that you have non-Egyptians in control of a significant portion of the country.
The Hyksos ruled the north of Egypt for over a century, but eventually the Egyptians managed to expel them. Their territory was finally back in the hands of the Egyptians, just as the Nile recovered to feed its land once more. New leaders emerged and were crowned as god kings. But the bond between the pharaoh and the people had been stretched and weakened. In Khufu's era, Egypt knew little but peaceful prosperity, and pharaohs took the credit. But the cataclysmic events of the intervening centuries showed the people that their god kings were not all powerful after all, and their borders were far from impregnable. And then a new pharaoh appeared who would equal Khufu's ambition. Twelve centuries after the death of Khufu, Egypt was once again on the rise. It was now a genuine superpower, a united country with an extensive empire in Africa and on the fringes of the Middle East. And it seemed the personal ambition of this new pharaoh was a match for Egypt's rich and vast geographical reach. He was one of the most famous pharaohs of the new kingdom, Ramesses II. A king with unshakable self-confidence, a man not from elite stock, who was every bit as powerful as his predecessors, but who, by mastering the arts of warfare, politics, and propaganda, excelled in a complex world which posed unimagined threats. The achievements of Ramesses II became popular mythology. This was a man whose ambition changed the world. He lived in the 13th century BC. He was the son of the great pharaoh Seti. He wasted no time in having his priests anoint his eldest son as heir to the throne. Ramesses was born into the 19th dynasty, a line of immense wealth and influence. These new bloods had overseen a renaissance in the empire, and Ramesses would go on to become the most iconic pharaoh of the new kingdom. To understand the scale of his achievements, they need to be put in the context of the empire that he had been born into, and in particular, how that territory had evolved in the 1300 years since the Old Kingdom. The pharaohs of the Old Kingdom were blessed with wealth, but they had also enjoyed something quite unknown to Ramesses and his family: security. During this earlier period, Egypt had been virtually free from the threat of invasion, and there were other signs that the gods were happy. The Nile was full and flowing. Its annual floods, rich in nutrients, ensured that the farmers enjoyed bumper harvests.
And as the living, breathing conduit to the gods, the old pharaohs took the credit for this period of abundance. The kudos allowed them to mastermind architectural projects of breathtaking ambition. Armies of workers were mobilized to build their pyramids, the largest constructions in the known world. But although these pharaohs could harness and exploit the manpower of an empire, they were remote rulers, worshipped from afar, rarely seen by their subjects. The pharaohs of the Old Kingdom did things one way, but Ramesses was living in different times. He had to find his own path.
The single-minded divine image of the pharaoh, of the pyramid-building age, had gone. Although still a divine being, in the New Kingdom, he is a little bit closer to Earth. Ramesses was clearly aware of that.
Ramesses' father, the great Seti, groomed him in this more exposed, crowd-pleasing role of accessible, accountable pharaoh.
In Ramesses' day, pharaoh has to work much harder at public relations. He can't afford to hide in his palace and let the monuments do the talking for him. He has to appear regularly before his people in very carefully stagecraft ceremonies, yet regularly so that they can see that he exists.
In the outer courtyards of the temples, Ramesses, as crown prince, took care of business with his father. Pyramids were part of a long distant era, but buildings were still central to the pharaoh's authority, and religious symbolism was as potent as ever. In the New Kingdom, Giza was no longer the center of pharaonic power. The heartland had shifted 400 miles south to Karnak on the Nile. The temple complex at Karnak. Like the Great Pyramid, the structures had sacred power, which offered a viable path to the afterlife. But unlike the elitist pyramids at Giza, the contemporary temples were far more accessible. One of Ramesses' first tasks was to expand, alongside his father, this existing religious site. Together, they created the biggest temple complex ever built and crammed it with one of the great engineering achievements of the ancient world, the hypostyle hall. These halls formed a route between the bustling outer temple courtyards and the sacred areas deeper within the architectural fantasy. Supporting a massive stone ceiling were 134 towering columns, the tallest over 70 feet high. At their base, these shafts are so thick that it takes more than seven people holding hands to encircle a single column. But, like the great pyramid builders of the Old Kingdom, Seti's engineers used deceptively simple methods to build the hall. As the column sections arrived from the quarry, the builders stood one on top of the other. As the walls of the hall rose, they filled it with sand to raise the floor so that each new section could be easily set in place. When the roof slabs were on, the workers drained the sand, finishing the columns on the way down. Like the ancient pyramids, Karnak temples symbolize the search for perfection and order within universal chaos. But they were more than symbolic. The deities were thought to inhabit the inner sanctum, where only the pharaoh and his high priest could enter. The hypostyle hall, Ramesses' great work, was a kind of fossilized incarnation of oral creation myths. The great columns resembled giant papyrus plants. They represented the primeval marshland that covered the earth at the dawn of creation. A significant development in the cult of the afterlife gave this building even more potency. So when Ramesses inherited the task of supervising the carving of the interior of the Hypostyle Hall, he was continuing a cosmically vital task. The dead pharaoh's spirit was no longer sustained in the heart of a massive pyramid. It now glittered from the very stone and the paint of the statues and reliefs. His artists were more than merely decorating. This imagery was transforming the hall into a potent source of religious and political power. The pharaoh in waiting was beginning to create the Ramesses brand.
The temples are where the pharaoh projects his image. They're the billboards in which he can advertise his glory and also his faithfulness to the gods. In part, he's trying to impress the gods themselves, not just the general populace, so he has two audiences.
Religious association and image management were only part of Ramesses' training. Still a teenager, Ramesses was put in charge of Egypt's elite fighting force. They were highly trained, super fit warriors, able to endure long, hard months of fighting far from home. Ramesses' father, Seti, had put him at the helm of the world's largest full-time army for a reason. Now a would-be ruler had to prove he could command a professional army. Another important distinction between the world of the Old Kingdom and the New. The New Egypt had become just one of many competing superpowers, each struggling for control of the region. To the west, it faced bandit Libyans. To the east, the might of the Hittites and Assyrians. And to the south lay the troublesome province of Nubia.
These were turbulent times, and the rulers of the new kingdom couldn't take the prosperity and peace of the old kingdom for granted. So Ramesses was groomed in the skills of a modern pharaoh, military might, and the faith of his people.
I'm sure Ramesses can't wait to become pharaoh. He's getting one of the best training that any future pharaoh ever got at the hands of his father, Seti I, who very carefully prepares him for the throne. But of course, he wants to have the top job for himself.
But when his chance came, would he be up to the challenge? Ah. 1290 BC. The pharaoh Seti died suddenly. Ramesses was crowned ruler of Egypt.
Like every pharaoh before him, the young Ramesses expected to reach the afterlife and become a god. But before that, he was determined to make his mark on the mortal world. This was clearly a man who wanted to be remembered in the history books. He knew that in the new era, building great temples was not enough. He had to shed blood.
Ramesses, when he accedes to the throne and becomes king himself, now it's his turn to shine. It's his turn to show the Egyptians and to show the other powers of the Near East that he is a powerful pharaoh, that he can compete on the world scale. And Ramesses must have thought, I can create for myself an empire of magnificent proportions. I'm not just going to be immortalized in stone, but I'm going to be immortalized by means of how far afield I can rule.
Just 4 years into his reign,
The young king unleashed his forces to Egypt's east. He skillfully subdued a string of small city-states in Canaan, modern-day Palestine and Israel, securing a lucrative trading corridor. Ramesses' victories swelled the royal coffers, and he lost no time in embarking on an epic building program to thank the gods and to proclaim to anyone who would listen his glorious triumphs.
The amazing thing about Ramesses is how confident he is when he becomes king. He's a young king, untried, and yet he hits the ground running. He immediately launches into this huge building program, very ambitious, and starts fighting wars overseas.
You have this balancing act happening, where you need to have a strong military, in part to ensure that the wealth keeps coming into Egypt, so that you can send that wealth off to your temples and thank Amun-Ra for helping you to have this huge empire.
At Luxor, near Karnak, he extended the temple, creating a great forecourt filled with colossal statues of himself. And in front of them, he sunk two giant obelisks carved from single blocks of pink granite. Like the pyramids before them, they pointed to the power of the skies. Ramesses was riding high. He'd scored some memorable conquests, but if he was to be remembered as the greatest pharaoh ever, then he had to outperform his ancestors. Military victories brought Ramesses some prestige and treasure, but these were regional land grabs. They didn't play on an epic scale. He decided to take his campaign to Egypt's most feared enemy, the Hittites. Here, Ramesses would face the biggest challenge of his military career. The Hittites were a sophisticated, organized, expansionist civilization and a rival superpower to Egypt. His father Seti had won a famous victory over the Hittites, commemorated on the walls of Karnak Temple when he captured the strategic town of Kadesh. But the Hittites won it back, a reverse the Egyptians could not forget.
Kadesh is a strategic location in Syria, but there's something in the Egyptian psyche that I think makes them obsessed with Kadesh.
Kadesh sat on the borderlands between Egypt and the Hittite kingdom, ruled by King Muwatallis. Whoever controlled it also enjoyed the surrounding prime agricultural land, an area today known as the Bekaa Valley. Four pharaohs had tried to secure this crucial strategic prize. Now, Ramesses staked his reputation on succeeding, where so many of his predecessors had failed.
Ramesses has a lot riding on Kadesh. He is a young pharaoh. The Egyptians are after one of the richest valleys and richest territories in that area. That's the prize catch. If they control Kadesh, they control the rest of the territory as well.
Only 5 years into his reign, Ramesses marched his army 400 miles out of Egypt to a plain now in Syria, then just west of Kadesh. Ramesses' spies informed him that the Hittite king, Muwatallis, commanded an awesome force. 37,000 foot soldiers, supported by 2,500 chariots. Muwatallis raged at this incursion. But the young pharaoh had reason to be confident.
The army that Ramesses II is mustering to go against Kadesh is the ultimate army. It's vastly superior and vastly different from anything which came before it.
Technologically conservative, the Egyptians had at last embraced new technology. They were introduced to the chariot during the Hyksos invasion and had adapted it to cope with sandy terrain, creating a really formidable weapon. This chariot was lightweight, highly maneuverable, and above all, fearsomely fast. Riding alongside the charioteer was the archer, armed with a new composite bow that combined wood and bone for added flexibility and power. The new design meant that arrows could be delivered with deadly accuracy across the length of 3 football pitches and with enough power to punch through the bronze armour of the Hittites. Alongside the chariots marched the infantry, carrying another improved weapon, the kopesh, a short sword with a lethal curved blade. Ramesses was about to put these weapons to the test in his biggest challenge yet. If he could capture Koresh, the young king would become a legend among his people, and the spoils would fund a building and public relations program that ensured his name lived on forever.
It is a do-or-die situation for him. He needs to prove that Egypt is in control, both to the Hittites, but also to his own followers, also to the people in Egypt.
As Ramesses and his army approached Kadesh, he received encouraging news. Egyptian scouts found 2 men, double agents, as it would turn out, hiding in a nearby forest. When the captives were interrogated, they claimed that the Hittite army was 120 miles away. The town stood unprotected. It seemed Kadesh was his for the taking. Impatient for victory, Ramesses split away from his troops and took a single division to within striking distance of the town. He ordered a second division to circle around to the north in a pincer action. But just as victory seemed within his grasp, disaster. Ramesses realized he'd fallen into a Hittite trap.
The fact of the matter is that the Hittite king is hiding behind the city of Kadesh, at Old Kadesh, and waiting to ambush Ramesses.
The Hittites struck hard and fast, buttressed by their possession of a new military technology, iron weapons. The young pharaoh faced a disastrous defeat. But just as the Hittites seemed poised to crush the Egyptians, his second division swooped down from the north and took the Hittites by surprise. Inspired by their arrival, Egypt's scattered troops regrouped and began a furious counterattack. Although the battle would become legendary, this was not the stuff of history. This was an awkward, messy, unsatisfying, and wasteful conflict.
With the armies of these 2 ancient superpowers fighting each other directly, this was probably the largest military engagement in world history up to that time.
The battle between Ramesses II and the Hittites is enormous. You've got massive amounts of slaughter on both sides.
The battle claimed thousands of lives, but at the end of the day, there was no outright victor. At dawn, Ramesses stood facing the Hittite king Muwatalis outside the walls of Kadesh, the massed ranks of their 2 enemy armies poised for another gory battle. But just as a bloodbath of appalling proportions seemed inevitable, something remarkable happened. In the face of certain slaughter, Ramesses and the Hittite king both pulled back from the brink. Each was unsure of their own strength, and there was a standoff. Neither wanted to risk total annihilation. The 2 men agreed a truce. Now, this wasn't what Ramesses came for. He'd failed to capture the Hittite prize, and now he must slink home empty-handed.
Ramesses is thinking, oh God, what have I done? I didn't win the day. I didn't even manage to capture Kadesh back. Nothing has gone the way I planned it. Now what do I do? How do I show to Egypt that I'm still the king, that I'm still should be king even? You know, what's going to make them believe that this isn't a complete disaster?
Ramesses' ambitions to become Egypt's greatest ever pharaoh were looking misguided and hollow.
Well, when Ramses gets home, this is going to be very embarrassing. He set out to conquer Gadesh, and he doesn't get it. So he has some explaining to do.
Remember, this wasn't the deferential Egypt of the great pyramid builders. The pharaoh was no longer beyond criticism. He knew people would be asking questions.
Just like any modern-day spin doctor, Ramesses set out to big up the positives. He hadn't actually lost the battle, which was a start, and although he must have been sick to the stomach with disappointment, he knew that he had to salvage the situation. This is now an age where the pharaohs are accountable, and it's really important that he gets good news out there and fast. It's a relatively recent development, this, in Egyptian society. I mean, a pharaoh like Khufu would never have had to explain himself to his subjects. But for Ramesses, public opinion and public confidence is really important. He knows that he has to keep not just his gods, but his people on side.
But if this was a more risky era for a pharaoh, it also offered more choices. Ramesses reached for a weapon even more punchy than chariots and bronze swords. Propaganda.
This is a wonderful opportunity for Ramesses to broadcast something to his audience that will make him the king that he will someday become.
Ramesses commissioned a series of stone reliefs to commemorate the Battle of Kadesh on temple walls, the length and the breadth of the kingdom.
So part of the sort of the heavy spin put onto the whole Kadesh campaign clearly is to make sure that his image remains what he wants it to be, that of the all-powerful, all-conquering pharaoh.
Well, when he sets up his record of the Battle of Kadesh, Ramesses proves that he's the greatest spin doctor of the ancient world.
The carvings tell the story not of an inconclusive truce, but a clear-cut victory. Ramesses is portrayed as the hero of the hour, who, separated from his troops, stands alone, valiant, against the Hittite ambush.
He claims he wept him good, but he didn't.
He's not going to show what really happened. He's going to show what he wants to have happened. So the image that he has depicted there is one that shows him routing the Hittites pretty much single-handedly, leading the way, sending them fleeing, trampling them under his horses and chariots, and really creating a sense of Egypt, and Ramesses himself as the personification of Egypt is the ultimate.
It was a political masterstroke. Ramesses had rewritten history and set his version of events in stone for all time. The king's lifelong talent for self-promotion had only just begun. Now he would start show-building on a grand scale. But though he had the ambition, he didn't have the resources available to his predecessor, the great pyramid builder Khufu. Ramesses would have to find new ways of realizing his grand architectural statements, with far fewer resources to play with. Abu Simbel, on Egypt's southernmost border with Nubia. In the sixth year of Ramesses' reign, he'd chosen this spot to build a monument to his own great self. Something so studdedly vainglorious, it would be admired long after his death. The age of the pyramids was over. No longer could a pharaoh harness Egypt's economy and population to his own ends. Employing tens of thousands of men to quarry millions of tons of stone and build a monument block by block was just too costly, unfeasible. Ramesses had a plan. Here, overlooking the Nile, he would create a great new temple, a shrine to himself and to the gods. But it wouldn't be built from quarried stone blocks. Ramesses' monument would be carved out of the cliff face. The cliffs at Abu Simbel were good quality sandstone, ideal for the job, which would require a workforce of hundreds rather than thousands. Mind you, it would still take decades. ...1284 BC. Highly skilled stonemasons started work at Abu Simbel. Their first task was to create four 70-foot-tall statues of Ramesses himself to guard the temple entrance.
The technical problems must have been amazing. You have to figure out how to scale these figures and carve them out of the side of the mountain. You have to put scaffolding up to support the workers that are going to do all this. You have to be able to envision these statues emerging from a raw mountainside.
The colossal stone men would embody Ramesses' reach and potency, but the carvings had another aim, one that linked him with his predecessor, Khufu, the pursuit of immortality. In Ramesses' time, pharaohs were laid to rest in secret underground tombs in the Valley of the Kings. But determined looters were still ransacking tombs for their treasure and their mummies. In the face of this threat, Egyptian beliefs about how to achieve immortality gradually evolved. It was no longer essential for the pharaoh's mortal remains to lie untouched for eternity. By the time of Ramesses, incarnation in stone offered a new insurance policy against death.
By having his face and his name, these are magical symbols, symbols that have power, symbols that themselves have immortality in them. And so even without the tomb lasting properly and perhaps the mummy being moved out of the tomb or being destroyed even, there are still other means by which he can ensure that he is remembered and is eternal.
Ramesses' hopes of eternal life relied on grand monuments. And there are few grander than Abu Simbel. Just like the pyramid builders, he had to see it finished before he died. But he had only a tiny fraction of the workforce available to the Old Kingdom pharaohs. And the tools for stone cutting had barely changed in the 13 centuries since the Great Pyramids. The only significant innovation was tougher chisels made of bronze. As the statues began to take shape, workers tunneled deep into the rock face. The finished temple would stretch an incredible 197 feet into the mountainside. Abu Simbel's interior had to be precisely aligned to the movements of the sun. Because Ramesses was a showman, he planned a spectacular surprise deep inside his temple. A light show worthy of the gods for centuries to come. But in the here and now, Ramesses was still fretting about his old enemies. The Hittites. Ramesses launched a new assault, striking deep into enemy territory. Soon he was locked in another series of frustrating battles, capturing cities only to lose control again as soon as his army marched on to new targets. If at any point he died, his temple would lie unfinished, risking his chance of an eternal life. He could end up a forgotten pharaoh. A footnote, a lost soul. For around 15 years, Ramesses gnawed away at the Hittite Empire. Frontier towns passed back and forth, but neither superpower gained the upper hand. Eventually, the two sides signed one of the world's first peace treaties. True to form, Ramesses used it to spin his skills as a diplomat on the walls of the temple at Karnak. With peace guaranteed, at last, he could dedicate his energies wholeheartedly to his grand project at Abu Simbel. It was a brash scheme. A nouveau riche king, bigging it up, trumpeting the power of his dynasty. He might not have employed the massive labour forces that built the pyramids, but in his absence, hundreds of Egyptians had sweated for him, shaping this sheer mountainside into a monument fit for the pharaoh. In 1266 BC, Ramesses had ruled for 24 years when he could finally unveil his masterpiece. His homage to himself, his self-centered gift to the gods.
Abu Simbel is a temple par excellence. It is a masterpiece. It has the king, it has the deities. It's fulfilling a particular function, the restoration of order, ensuring that chaos doesn't enter into the world. But it does it in an incredibly aesthetic way.
In tune with this more troubled, complex age, the temple served a double purpose. It was also an imposing warning to Egypt's neighbours to the south.
I don't think Abu Simbel is just a spectacular engineering feat built to the glory of Ramses and his godhood. It also serves as a stark warning to the Nubians in case they should rebel. It's a giant beware of Pharaoh sign.
Inside stands a spectacular avenue of 33-foot-tall statues of Ramesses, evidence of his belief in himself and his incarnation as a living god. Deep inside the mountain, Ramesses' brilliant trick of the light was finally triggered. In the sanctuary at the heart of the temple sits Ramesses, enthroned as a god alongside three other deities. Twice a year, at sunrise, the sun's rays penetrate through the dim inner halls, puncturing almost 200 feet of darkness. Here, they illuminate the deified Ramesses and his companion gods. The message is unmistakable. Here, Ramesses will overcome death's long night and live forever. But Abu Simbel wasn't his last gift to the world. Still buoyed up by his own success, Ramesses made a concerted bid for eternal magnificence. His builders erected hundreds more temples, giant statues, even a whole city.
And so Ramesses embarks on this huge building campaign. He's going to put temples throughout Egypt, from the north down to the south.
Ramesses is everywhere, in stone and bronze, promoting the Ramesses brand today, and perhaps in the hereafter. His insurance policy to cheat death.
Ramesses' manic covering of monuments with his names and images may well be, at least partly, a desire to ensure that there's always be enough images of him left on earth to guarantee his eternal life.
Despite a lifetime of warfare, Ramesses lived to an astonishing age, almost certainly into his 90s.
He left at least 45 sons and 40 daughters, and more monuments than any other pharaoh before or since. His self-conscious PR strategy had worked. His nation wept for their loss.
It must have been an unbelievable shock when Ramses finally died. You have to remember that he lived for three times the average lifespan of the typical Egyptian of his day. Imagine how traumatic that would be to lose a leader that had ruled you for that long, in which even your grandfather couldn't remember another king.
Ramses had served his country well, giving his people three generations worth of peace and security, doing his bit to call down onto earth the holistic harmony of Maat. Now, priests preserved his body in accordance with the rituals that had survived since the Old Kingdom.
Back then, Khufu's mummy had been protected by an unprecedented security system involving massive slabs of granite.
But Ramses' mummy wasn't placed in a pyramid. He was destined for a secret tomb, gouged out of a mountain in the Valley of the Kings. Would this ruse work? Would the tomb robbers be frustrated? Although the Egyptian Empire flourished for another 1,000 years, no single pharaoh could quite match up to Ramses II. He had ruled over Egypt for 67 years, leaving behind a wealth of monuments. His life spanned 9 decades.
I think one of the greatest testaments to Ramses' success as a pharaoh is that he had so many imitators. You have Ramses III through Ramses XI, several pharaohs that tried to imitate Ramses II, but none of them ever equaled him for the length of their reign or the greatness of their accomplishments.
The discovery of Ramses' ultimate fate would remain a mystery for another 1,000 years. On the 6th of July, 1881, Egyptologist Emil Brüsch was lowered down the sheer cliffs of Deir el-Bahri near the Valley of the Kings to the entrance of a cave. Inside, he discovered a secret cache of around 40 mummies. Inscriptions revealed most of them to be Egyptian pharaohs and their queens. After their original tombs were ransacked, they'd been reburied without valuables, a canny trick to frustrate other would-be tomb raiders. And one of them was the body of the man celebrated as the greatest pharaoh of all time, Ramses II. Ramses' mummy endured, perfectly preserved, for 3,000 years in the humblest of tombs. Scientific analysis has revealed that he was surprisingly tall for his time, 5'7". He had red hair in his youth, reproduced with embalmer's dye. By the time he died, he suffered from severe arthritis and mouth decay. But what sights this ravaged, splendid face has seen.
The fact that we're sitting here today talking about Ramses II is, in a sense, exactly what he would have wanted. It is his immortality that's being achieved right here, right now.
Ramses' architectural achievements and those of Khufu, the great pyramid builder 1,000 years before, were the two high points of Egyptian monumental building. These two pharaohs bookend Egypt's most splendid age,
and the contrast in their lives illustrates the profound shift in Egyptian civilization. From an age of gods and absolute leaders to one of political manoeuvring and warfare. Ramesses expanded his country's borders, and for four decades he protected the empire from its powerful rivals. Abu Simbel stands today as one of the most audacious and beguiling temples in the world. But Ramesses' architectural legacy extends beyond that single monument. His blustering buildings and statues can still be found right across Egypt. Perhaps most of all, Ramesses was an imaginative, forward-thinking ruler who did more than survive in a complex and dangerous time. He thrived. A man skilled in warfare, politics, and propaganda, he embodied a very changed Egyptian world. Less certain, less safe than that experienced by Khufu 1,000 years before.
These two men led very different lives. Khufu was an absolute ruler, whereas Ramesses had to duck and dive a bit to keep a grip on political power. And if you set their stories up side by side, what you see is a profound shift in the way that Egyptian society worked. But I tell you what they both share. Both men believed that they could achieve eternal life by travelling to the stars. Whereas actually, it was human inspiration. It was the work of men with feet of clay that's given them immortality. But we still remember them because their structures still survive. These were pharaohs who thought that their feats of engineering would bring them physically closer to their gods. Whereas actually, they brought them closer to all of us.
The achievements these men struggled to realise, that today we celebrate as wonders of the world, remind us that ancient Egypt was not some kind of mythical kingdom, but a real place inhabited by real, flawed, inspiring people.